most of the things that have happened to me have been accidental, in the sense that I was brought up to be something posh, like in the church or the army or the city or the law or one of those things. And that's my whole education from private school through Eton was for that. And then, of course, the war came, and I was in the army for 6 years. I went to a steelworks first and then into the army. And when I came out of it, it was a clean slate almost. I hadn't forgotten everything I learned, but it's still quite useful for crosswords, my classical education, but not much else.
Of Humphrey Lyttelton's career may well have been accidental. It was certainly unexpected. His father was a highly respected housemaster at Eton, and for generations the blue-blooded Lyttletons had distinguished themselves as pillars of society. Right from the start, the young Humphrey was a renegade spirit. Yet, in spite of everything, he's ended up as a national institution. At 72, known to everyone as Humph, he's still spreading the joyful gospel of jazz with the famous band he first set up in 1948. Ever since then, he's been recording, composing, and playing the kind of trumpet that made him a legend with fans of all ages. In between, he's also made his mark as a writer, broadcaster, and cartoonist. But even from his earliest years, it was the idea of making music that captivated the infant Humph.
From birth, I'd been in love with instruments, and by that I mean toy instruments as well. I can remember now the excitement, lying awake at nights when I'd been promised a toy saxophone for either a birthday or Christmas. One of those sort of tin affairs, you know, with reeds in it, made a noise just like any old sort of reed thing. And when I got that, I thought it was the best thing I ever saw. And I went through a whole lot of different instruments, harmonicas and all those things. And my father's brother, Carol Lyttelton, he'd been a chaplain in the war, and he gave me for a birthday present a boys' brigade snare drum, the sort you hitch onto your belt. You know. I used to bang away on this, and I got reasonably proficient on my own account. And my mother thought we'll get some lessons for him. And living at Eton near Windsor with the castle and the Victoria barracks, she found an advert and found that there was an ex-Coldstream Guards bandmaster called Mr. Glass, who was advertising drum lessons. And I remember he came down to our house at Eton, and he was a great man. I loved him, lovely man. And my mother said, like mothers do, she said, he's taught himself an awful lot on his own, you know, to which he said, well, we'll soon unlearn him all that, which he proceeded to do. So I studied the snare drum for quite a long time, and I could really read drum music better than I could read, and still can read drum music better than I can read ordinary music. But the trumpet was absolutely, I can remember to this day, the smell of the sort of velveteen inside to the trumpet case. My mother and I were at the Eton and Harrow match, beginning of July in 1936,
You would be 15.
I would be 15. And my father was a member of the MCC, and I was what they called a dry bob at Eton, which meant that you played cricket. A wet bob did rowing, and a slack bob did neither. I was temperamentally a slack bob, but I was actually assigned to go and playing these awful games of cricket. So I think in general one was expected to go and support Eton at the Eton and Harrow match. And my mother wasn't a cricket fan, and we sat there, we got bored stiff, and we used to walk round the ground hoping that a wicket would fall while we weren't looking. The match used to be on the Friday and the Saturday, and she'd promised me that when the shops opened on the Monday, we'd go to Charing Cross Road and buy a trumpet or an instrument. And on the Saturday, we were walking around, and we saw an open gate, and I said, do we have to wait until Monday? And she said, no, I think it'll be all right. We'll get a taxi. So we went into the Charing Cross Road. And I was dressed in the tribal gear which you wore for the Eton and Harrow match. I had a top hat and the tailcoat, the ordinary Eton tailcoat, but with a silver waistcoat a pale blue carnation in my lapel and a rolled umbrella with a pale blue tassel. And this apparition walked into Selma's in the Charing Cross Road, and they took it all very bravely. And we walked round looking at all these fabulous instruments. Oh, my word. Everything. They had all the brass instruments and everything. My mother tailed round behind me as I was looking at the trumpets, saying, you know, wouldn't a clarinet be rather nice, you know, quieter and softer? But I was dead set on the trumpet. So we bought one. It was the very lowest price range. Trumpet and mouthpiece, a case, one mute, a book by my idol on the trumpet, Nat Ganella, who was one of the great British jazz trumpeters in those days, and one free lesson from a West End dance musician. And the whole of that package cost £4 in 1936. It's incredible to think of that. It was called a Manhattan Special, the trumpet. I remember every detail about it. And I was staying at my grandfather's house, and on the Saturday night, well, before I went to bed on the Saturday night, I got the trumpet out, you know, and looked at it and read up the stuff in the book. And then in the morning, I went upstairs to the top. It was a Victorian, narrow Victorian house in Cadogan Square. And I went up to the top floor where there was a loo. And I went in there, locked myself in, and started to play. And, of course, you know, the first notes on a trumpet are agonizing. Well, they are really notes. I mean, the 16 notes come out simultaneously. It's just a blast. And all the pigeons flew away and everything. But over the weekend, I worked at this, and eventually I got so that I could play the scale of C, the trumpet C. And so I went off on the Monday back to Selma's to have this lesson from a man called Sim Savile, who is a very typical West End dance band musician in the sense that he wore the black suit and the black trousers, which was the all-purpose thing. I mean, he'd have the, I think he had a light grey tie on or something or other in the daytime, and he'd obviously got the bow in his pocket. And in the evening, you took off the grey tie and you put on the bow, and there you were, ready. So he started with the thing of, you know, let's try and get a note out and all this sort of thing. So I pipped out quite a reasonable note then. I mean, it was a bit weak, but I mean, it was reasonable. And he said, oh, well, he said, now, I'm going to show you the scale of C. And being a cocky youngster of 15, I said, oh, you mean this one? And I played the scale of C. And he was impressed enough to say that I was going to go places. I always remember that. If you keep on with this, he said, you're going to go places.
Well, he was right, wasn't he?
And he was right, yes.
As a teenager, what was feeding your enthusiasm for jazz? Well, was it wireless? How did wireless come into it, or records, in what sort of order?
It started with my mother used to like light music, and she had a lot of records of, oh, all kinds of things. The things I remember particularly that struck me, and this must have been the late 20s, was Leighton and Johnston. Remember, this was a black duo. And Turner Leighton, of course, came over here and became a cabaret artist many years later. But Leighton and Johnston, I used to love their things. I can remember the songs.
What were they?
Well, I can remember I'm in the Seventh Heaven. And I remember a thing I actually recorded with my band years later. I like to go back in the evening, back to my old hometown. It may be slow, I want to go. It's mighty close to heaven, that's one thing I know. And Turner Leighton used to play lovely, not exactly jazz piano, but very rhythmic and smooth piano. And one of them had the high voice and the other one. And I used to love that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.